जी, माय फ्रेंड एंड प्रेसिडेंट जीएसटीपीएम दिनेश तांबड़े, विनोद मस्के, अदर कमिटी मेंबर्स ऑफ जीएसटीपीएम, पास्ट प्रेसिडेंट्स ऑफ जीएसटीपीएम एंड अदर ऑफिस बेरर्स ऑफ जीएसटीपीएम एंड एआईएफटीपी, अ वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल ऑफ यू. इट्स इंडीड अ प्लेजर एंड अ प्रिविलेज to come live on this virtual meeting, which is organized jointly by AFTP and GSTPM. The composition scheme and the reverse charge mechanism, they are associated with lots of issues. It is a good opportunity for me as a speaker to go into the various act, rules, notifications associated with this. Both these topics and I hope I'll be able to give justice to the task allotted to me by both these associations. I hope I'm clear and audible and my screen is there in front of you. I've shared the screen. Perfect. I hope it is available. It's available, no? Fine. So we have two topics. One is the composition scheme and other is reverse charge mechanism. I'll first take up the composition scheme and then we'll go for the RCM provisions. Well, friends,
प्रणव भाई अनम्यूट करो आपको. यस गो अहेड.
या फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल जस्ट बिफोर गोइंग इनटू द टॉपिक प्रॉपर, वेल आई डू होप दैट all of you are safe and sound, healthy, taking good care of yourselves amidst just corona crisis times. The government itself is also going overboard and trying to help all citizens as well as the MSME sector, and the composition scheme that we are going to talk today is one of the aspects which is very close to the MSME sector. And these are the small dealers whose care the government had thought of to take at the beginning or at the onset of GST. And various provisions or benefits have been granted for the small dealers under this composition scheme. Although various benefits have come, but they have come, of course, with the conditions applied tag. And with the passage of time, there have been so many changes, so many suggestions which have been given by the small dealers. So many difficulties were being faced by the small dealers, and I'm very much aware because when GST first came in July 2017, we at GSTPM were striving to make so many suggestions, representations on the various aspects applicable to the small dealers. Over a period of time, many of the suggestions have been accepted by the government, and many changes have also been made to the scheme. And that is why the scheme, which is actually for small dealers, has in fact become very complicated, and so many conditions have become applicable to the scheme. Well, basically, the purpose of the scheme was to give an alternate method of levy of tax for small taxpayers who have a smaller turnover. When the GST law. Hello.
Hello.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The GST law first introduced. The limit was first designed at 50 lakh rupees. It subsequently was taken up to 1 crore. Then a provision was made to increase the limit up to 1.5 crore. The provision came earlier, but the effective date of implementation of that 1.5 crore limit came at a much later stage. the objective of the scheme is to bring simplicity and reduce the compliance cost for the small tax. We'll see how simple the scheme is going ahead with this. But yes, it has come with a laudable objective to bring simplicity and reduce the compliance cost. Basically, the scheme is available only, was available primarily only to the suppliers of goods. Two kinds of suppliers, one was manufacturers, other was the other dealers. It was not applicable to service providers, except for the restaurant service providers. So only restaurant service providers were earlier allowed to apply for the composition scheme, others were not allowed. A marginal value of services was then subsequently introduced in the scheme available for the suppliers of goods. We need to understand that when we are talking of composition scheme, there are two aspects to it. One, the composition scheme which deals with goods, and second, the composition scheme which deals with services, which was subsequently introduced. And that was introduced in 2019 by notification number 2 of 2019. So for service providers, the scheme has come from January 2009, from 1st April 2019. For others, it has come from 1st July 2017. So what are the advantages of the composition scheme? As envisaged, a composition dealer is not required to file multiple GST returns, that is GSTR1, GSTR3B. That was one of the purpose. They need not maintain details of stock and tax payable, because we know that under the GST law, as per rule 56, all the dealers are required to maintain proper books of accounts and the details of stock and tax payable. Of course, the composition dealers will have to maintain books of accounts, but the details of stock need not be maintained by the composition dealers. And they need not issue a tax invoice. The simple bill of supply will suffice for them. So the tax invoice need not be issued. Second, there was a flexibility which was provided. The dealers are given an option to switch over to composition scheme from a regular scheme, or switch from a composition scheme to the regular scheme of taxation. So flexibility has also been provided to the small dealers. They need to evaluate which scheme they want to opt for. And of course, the tax liability has been limited to either 1% or 5% or 6%, as the case may be, instead of the regular rates of tax. We'll come to those rates of tax as and when we go ahead. And the purpose of this was that this should give a better liquidity, as the taxes are at a lower rate, to the small dealers. It was with this objective that the composition schemes were introduced. Of course, the scheme has certain restrictions and disadvantages. There is a territorial restriction, in the sense that there cannot be any interstate transactions which can be carried out by a composition scheme dealer or dealer who has opted for composition scheme. So it has to be only within the state. There cannot be interstate transactions. The composition dealers are not eligible for input tax credit. And I think that is a big decision that the composition dealers need to take, that whether they need to avail input tax credit and charge taxes on their outward supplies, or not avail input tax credit, not maintain stock details, etc., and apply for composition scheme. So I think every such composition dealer will have to take a decision, especially based on the criteria of input tax credit. Of course, there are further restrictions in the sense that the taxpayer would not be able to supply goods through an e-commerce portal, which is the future of retail business. Because we all are seeing that even in this lockdown area era, digital businesses are growing, sales through websites and through e-commerce are enhancing, but care needs to be taken by such composition dealers that it is only for brick and mortar stores that the composition scheme is applicable. It is not applicable to dealers who are under the who are supplying goods through e-commerce portal. Well, after the onset of GST, certain goods were not included under the GST regime and have remained under the VAT regime. That is the motor spirits and alcoholic liquor for human consumption, etc. They are still not leviable to tax under GST. So all those goods which are not leviable to GST The composition scheme is not applicable to those goods. It is applicable only for the goods which are leviable to tax under GST. And one more important aspect is that the composition dealer cannot collect tax from the customer and has to pay tax from his own pocket. So that is going to be a cost for the composition dealer. On the one side, the composition dealer is not going to get the input tax credit. So hence the cost of the goods would increase, or the cost of the services which he is availing, that would increase. On the other hand, he cannot collect taxes from his customer and will have to pay from his own pocket. So if the goods are costing 18%, and say if the composition dealer, that dealer is opting for the composition scheme, and say he is liable to pay 1% tax on his outward supply, then the cost of GST comes to 18% plus 1%, that is 19% becomes his cost. I don't know whether the margins are that high to allow the dealer to take such a decision. But yes, this is the provision of the law. So who can opt for a composition scheme? As I said earlier, only small taxpayers up to 1.5 crores turnover are eligible. For the northeastern states, there's a separate limit of 75 lakh rupees. Yeah. A composition dealer who is supplying goods is otherwise not allowed to have is not allowed to provide any services except to the extent of 10% of his turnover or rupees 5 lakhs, whichever is higher. But that option has come from 1st of February 2019. No such option was available earlier to the composition dealers. So in case if a composition dealer is providing, is selling goods, but he is getting a commission income, then in the earlier stage, up to the limit specified over here, he was not eligible to opt for the composition scheme. After lots of representation by various associations, including our associations, some leeway was given by the government, and up to 10% of the turnover, if the dealer is providing services up to 10% of the turnover, then such dealer can opt for the composition scheme of goods. But that is restricted to a maximum of 5 lakh rupees. One more aspect is that if the turnover of all businesses registered with the same PAN should be taken into consideration to calculate the turnover. Say there's a small dealer or a small company who is wanting to offer composition, and say it is registered in Maharashtra as well as in Gujarat. The turnover of all the businesses under the same PAN. So if it is a multi-state company, then for calculating the aggregate turnover, both these turnovers will have to be counted, and both of the businesses in Maharashtra as well as Gujarat, both will have to opt for the composition scheme. The composition dealer cannot say that for the state of Gujarat he will go for the regular scheme and for the state of Maharashtra he will go for the composition scheme. So that also needs to be taken care. What are the GST rates for a composition dealer? So there are two rates which are applicable, or rather there are two rate periods which are applicable. From 1st July 17 to 31st December 17, there were the higher rates, and they were reduced from 1st of January 2018 until late. The same rates are going on. So in the case of manufacturer other than the manufacturer of notified goods, the rate of tax applicable now is 1%, that is 0.5% CGST and 0.5% SGST. Then in the case of restaurants not serving alcohol, the rate of tax remains at 5% of turnover in the state. And any other supplier who is eligible for composition levy under Section 10 and the corresponding rules, for them the rate remains 1%. So basically the differentiation between the manufacturer and other supplier which was there, that differentiation has been done away with from 1st of January 2018. So, So dealer who is supplying goods and opting for the composition scheme, the rate of tax is 1%. You know, for all the goods that are opted under the composition scheme, and only restaurant services are allowed to such dealers, and the rate of tax thereof is 5%. One important change which came from 1st of February 19 was that this 1% of the turnover was the tax which is applicable only in the supply of taxable supplies of goods and services, which hitherto was not there. So, for example, say in the year 1718, when the scheme was first introduced, a composition dealer, say a groceries merchant, a person who is a kirana store owner, and he is selling exempt goods as well as taxable goods. For them, if he had opted for the composition scheme prior to 1st of Feb 19, then in those periods, on the entire turnover, he was liable to pay tax under composition at the rate of 1%. That is, even on the exempted supplies, the tax was becoming payable, and this was a real hardship. The government understood this hardship, and hence this amendment came from 1st of February 2019. And the taxable supplies of goods and services are only liable to tax. So hence, now a kirana merchant can still opt for the composition scheme and pay only for the pay tax only on its taxable supplies and not on its exempt supplies. There was one more amendment which came in. See, here we need to understand that for calculating the aggregate turnover on which the tax is payable by the dealer, the aggregate turnover includes turnover of all supplies, all taxable supplies, exempt supplies, exports, and interstate sales. So whenever a dealer is required to calculate his liability qua the total turnover which is liable to tax, or for the total turnover for which he has to check whether he is eligible for the composition scheme or not, he needs to see the aggregate turnover. But while calculating the tax liability, while discharging the tax liability, he has to see the turnover in the state for making the tax payment. And there, the amendment has come in by Finance Act number 2 of 2019, that the expression turnover in the state shall not include the value of the following supplies. Supplies from the first day of April of financial year up to the day when such person becomes liable for registration under this act, and exempt supplies of services provided by way of extending deposits, loans or advances, insofar as the consideration is represented by way of interest or discount. So, now what does this mean? So, there are two criteria. One criteria is, say there is a dealer who wants to opt for the composition scheme. For that, he has to see the aggregate turnover. Once having checked on the aggregate turnover, okay, that in the previous year, the aggregate turnover was less than the limit of 1.5 crores. And if in the current year, the dealer wants to opt for the composition scheme. Hello. And he's a dealer who is going to take registration for the first time. In such cases, the basic threshold limit will not be included while discharging the tax liability of the composition dealer. Say, for example, during financial year 2021, a dealer is applying for registration and opting for the composition scheme. Then his liability will not be there on the first 20 lakh of rupees for which he becomes liable for registration, or rather, now the limit has enhanced to 40 lakhs subject to registration criteria. So on the first 40 lakh of rupees, he'll not be liable to pay tax on that. And on the further supplies which are made beyond that amount, beyond that turnover, only on those turnover, the dealer will be liable to pay tax under the composition scheme. And while calculating the aggregate the turnover, if any interest income is received by that dealer who has opted for composition scheme, that interest income is not to be included in the aggregate turnover, in the taxable turnover. So I think for this basic threshold, these two turnover are to be excluded, and on the balance turnover only the person will be liable to pay tax on its taxable supplies. Yes. So for calculation of the aggregate turnover, what all would be included? It is mentioned over here. So this aggregate turnover is for determining eligibility under the composition scheme, because there could be dealers who are under the regular scheme of taxation and would be wanting to opt in for joining into the composition scheme or opting out of the composition scheme. At both those places, we need to understand and determine the turnover or the aggregate turnover for those dealers. So what does the term aggregate turnover include? The term aggregate turnover includes the value of all taxable supplies, including exports, value of all exempt supplies, value of interstate supplies of persons having the same PAN to be computed on all India basis. So all these are included. What does it exclude? The turnover excludes this CGST, value of inward supplies on which tax is payable under RCM, and value of supply of any exempt services by way of extending deposits, loans or advances, that is by way of interest income. All these are to be excluded while calculating the term aggregate turnover. Right. So we have seen that who can opt for a composition scheme. So the person who wants to opt for a composition scheme, there are two criteria. One is composition scheme qua the goods, other is composition scheme qua the services. For the composition scheme qua the goods, the dealer cannot be engaged in supplying any services except restaurant services. He should not be a manufacturer of the notified goods, which are manufacturer of ice cream, pan masala, tobacco and aerated water. So he should not be a manufacturer of those goods. He should not be engaged in supplying any goods or services which are not leviable to tax under this act. That is all the petroleum products and all those products, petrol, diesel, etc. It should not be in, because this it mentions which are not leviable tax. This is not mentioning which are exempted. Not leviable to tax means the non-taxable supply of goods which are not leviable to tax. So it should so in case if a dealer is selling goods which are exempted, still he can opt for the composition scheme. But if he is selling goods which are not leviable to tax, he cannot engage in he cannot opt for the composition scheme. Of course, he cannot make any interstate outward supplies of goods or services. Cannot make this way already taken up the supply of goods or services through an electronic commerce operator who is required to collect tax at source under section 52. Here also there is some issue that say in case if the dealer is having wants to offer the composition scheme, and say he is having his own website also and he wants to sell goods from his own website, because when we go to the definition of electronic commerce operator, it says that any person who is selling goods through an electronic portal, then it will be termed as an e-commerce operator. So this does not mean that every person who is having his own website, selling his goods through his own website and as well as having his own shop, that person cannot opt for a composition scheme. Only if that person is, say, opting to sell goods through a portal like Flipkart or Amazon, those are the electronic commerce operator who collect the money on behalf of the supplier and remit it to the supplier, and they are the companies which are liable to collect tax at source under section 52. So only those supplies to such electronic commerce operators who collect the consideration on behalf of these dealers are not eligible to opt for the composition scheme. If you are having your own website, if the composition dealer is having his own website and selling through its own website, that is not a restriction to opt for the composition scheme. Well, we have seen that a dealer opting for composition scheme cannot make outward supplies of taxable goods, but can he make interstate purchases? I don't think there is any restriction to make interstate purchases by a person opting for the composition scheme. A person opting for composition scheme can make interstate purchases. There is no such restriction. The restriction is only on the outward supplies. As regards the scheme for the service providers, I'll come to the details thereof in the subsequent slides. There are further conditions as regards availing the composition scheme for goods. Yeah, the dealer cannot purchase goods from interstate supplier, but if such goods are in stock, rather if the goods held in stock by him have not been purchased from an unregistered supplier and where purchased, he pays tax under subsection 4 of section 9. So basically, while opting for the composition scheme, in case the dealer has purchased any goods from an unregistered dealer which are there in stock, and on that purchases from the unregistered dealer, if he has not paid any tax, if he has not paid any tax under section 9.4, then such dealer is not eligible to opt for the composition scheme. Secondly, as I was speaking earlier, the goods held in stock by him on the appointed day have not been purchased in the course of interstate trade or commerce, or imported from a place outside India, or received from his branch or his agent outside the state. So at the time on the appointed day, so this provision was applicable when GST was introduced. In case if the dealer was having any goods in stock as on 30th June 2017, which were interstate purchases, that restriction was there at the time of introduction of GST, that such person should not have any stock. Because basically the purpose at that point of time, if we try to understand the entire scheme of composition, when it was first introduced, when GST came in, we all know that that there was a tax on URD purchases, on purchases from unregistered dealers. The entire scheme of taxation was such that in case, even if a dealer is opting for a composition scheme and if he's making purchases from unregistered dealers, he was liable to pay tax under reverse charge on the purchases made by him from unregistered suppliers, so that such dealers are at parity with the dealers who are under the regular scheme of taxation. And both this type of dealers, once they reach out to the market, they are at parity. But and down the line, the URD purchases notification was the tax on URD purchase notification was kept in suspension, was suspended, the proviso was omitted, and hence as of now, what has happened is the dealers who are under composition scheme, they can make purchases from goods from an unregistered supplier without paying any tax. That disparity has come in now after the amendment of that provision in section 9.4. But when the scheme was introduced, at that point of time, in case if there were any interstate purchases or purchases from URD, then the dealer was not eligible for opting of the composition scheme. Of course, the certain parameters like the supplier shall maintain the words, mention the words composition taxable person not eligible to collect tax on supplies at the top of the bill, and also mention the words composition taxable person on every notice and signboard. I don't know how many are maintaining that, but these are the conditions that he was he's liable to pay to maintain. As far as the scheme for service providers is concerned, the scheme for service providers of goods, those who want to opt for a composition scheme as service provider, the basic criteria is that such persons should not be eligible to pay tax under section 10(1) of the said act, that only if a person is not eligible under composition scheme of goods, then only he can opt for the service provider's composition scheme. So that condition needs to be kept in mind for a person who wants to opt for a composition scheme as a service provider. And of course, he should not be engaged in making supplies of ice cream, pan masala, or tobacco. Here, he is not a manufacturer, but he is supplying ice cream, pan masala, or tobacco. So that's the difference. The aggregate turnover for the persons opting for composition scheme should be less than 50 lakhs in the preceding year. Of course, as I told earlier, he should not be eligible to pay tax under Section 10(1). That is, he should not be eligible under the composition scheme for goods. Then only he is eligible for the composition scheme for services. Both are separate schemes. The composition scheme for service providers as per Section 10, Subsection 2A, read with Notification Number 2 of 2019. Whereas the composition scheme for goods is as per Section 10(1). And the rate of tax which is applicable for the persons opting for the composition scheme for services is 3% CGST and 3% SGST. So 6% is the rate of tax which is applicable to such providers. Then comes the question that once a service provider or a person who has opted for a composition scheme and the basic limit has been exceeded, or the basic aggregate turnover of that dealer has exceeded during the year, then what would happen to that dealer? Will he be liable for tax? The answer is yes. The option availed by a registered person shall lapse with effect from the day on which his aggregate turnover during a financial year exceeds the limit specified. I think I have taken up an example also subsequently. We'll come to that example for this. The liability to pay tax under Section 9(3) and 9(4), that is reverse charge mechanism liability, is applicable for dealers opting for composition scheme. So in case if the provisions of reverse charge mechanism say a composition dealer is going to pay to an advocate legal fees, then he is liable for paying tax under reverse charge mechanism. There is no concession given to such composition, to the composition dealers, for not paying tax under reverse charge mechanism. So whatever tax is payable under reverse charge mechanism, the composition dealers will have to abide by those provisions also. How to opt for a composition scheme? A person who applies for fresh registration under Rule 8(1) can, at the time of registration in REG01, intimate that he is opting for the composition scheme. So at that point of time, he can mention in Part B of GST REG1. A person who wants to switch into the composition scheme, then he has to intimate in form GST CMP02, duly signed or verified through electronic verification code, prior to the commencement of the financial year for which the option to pay tax under the scheme is exercised. For financial year 2021, because of this corona crisis, the date is extended till 30th June. So in case a person wants to opt into a composition scheme, say a dealer is already under the regular scheme of taxation, but his turnover is below the prescribed limits and he wants to opt into the composition scheme, he has to make an application before the beginning of the financial year and not after the beginning of the financial year. So, and that option is available at that point of time only. And when a person is wanting to switch into the composition scheme, let's understand that there could be purchases which are made by the dealer, and there is an input tax credit which is availed by that dealer who wants to opt for composition scheme. So what will happen to that credit? That credit needs to be reversed. the dealer will have to file a form GST ITC 03 and reverse the ITC as provided in section 18.4 on all the inputs or semi-finished goods or finished goods in stock in accordance with the provisions of Rule 44.4. And for that, a time limit of 60 days has been given from the commencement of the relevant year. Within 60 days from the commencement of the relevant year, whatever ITC was availed qua the goods in stock, that ITC will have to be reversed. As far as the compliance is to be done by the composition dealer, from 1st April 2019 onwards, the scheme has changed. The dealer who wants to a composition dealer is required to file quarterly statement containing the details of payment of self-assessed tax in GST CMP 08. So a composition dealer from financial year 19-20 onwards just has to file CMP 08 on a quarterly basis by 18th of the month after the end of the financial year, after the end of the quarter, and furnish return in GSTR 4 for the financial year by 30th April from the end of such financial year. So from financial year 19-20 onwards, much relief has been provided to the composition dealers. So instead of the monthly 3B return which was going earlier, the GSTR 4 which was being filed earlier, 3B through the tax payment and GSTR 4 for the return filing which was going on earlier till 31st March, that has changed, and from 19-20 it is a quarterly CMP 08 and yearly GSTR 4 which is required to be filed. For the quarter ending March 20, the new dates for filing GST CMP 08 are 7th July 2020 for March 20, and for GSTR 4 the annual return, or rather we can say it's the yearly return, not the annual return, because annual return still remains at its place. The yearly return for the composition dealers has to be filed by 15th July 2020. Of course, the annual return is also required to be filed by such dealers in GSTR 9A by 31st December of the succeeding year. And of course, whatever extensions are related to that. And if any additional liability is there, that additional liability can be reflected in GSTR 9A. So one question comes that from 19-20, the dealer is going to file a yearly GSTR 4 and the annual return is also an annual return, which is once in a year. So what's the difference between that? Well, there are certain details of transaction-wise details of inward supplies, etc., which are required to be mentioned in the GSTR 4 form. Those details are not there in the GSTR 9A form. So there are certain details which are required to be furnished in GSTR 4 but not in GSTR 9A, and in case at the by the end of the year, if any, because the time limit to file GSTR 4 is only up to 30th April under the normal scenarios, provided the date is not extended. And in case if there are any further liabilities, then those liabilities can be included in the GSTR 9A, which can be furnished by the end of the financial year. So until 31st March 2019, the dealer was required to file return in GSTR 4 on quarterly basis on or before 18th day of the month after end of relevant year by 31st December. And of course, as I told earlier, the dealer is required to maintain all records as per Section 35 and Rule 56, except the stock of goods and the details of tax payable. All these compliances and records will have to be maintained by the dealer. This we have already covered. Yeah, let's take some examples. ABC is engaged in supply of goods. His aggregate turnover in preceding financial year 19-20 is rupees 70 lakhs. So in 19-20 turnover 70 lakhs. Since aggregate turnover does not exceed 1.5 crore, he is eligible to opt for the composition scheme in the current year. So he can file a GST CMP 02 form on the GST portal before start of the financial year, that is by 31st March 2020. Of course, because of the lockdown, this option is still available till 30th June 2020. So in case any dealer wants to opt in for the composition scheme, that time limit for filing GST CMP 02 is still available. Further, as discussed earlier, in 2020, he can supply services other than national services up to a value not exceeding 10% of his turnover. It is 10% of 70 lakhs or rupees 5 lakhs, whichever is higher. Right. So, in case if such a dealer is getting commission income of 4 lakhs, then yes, he can opt for the composition scheme. If he has received a commission income of 6 lakhs, then he is not eligible to opt for the composition scheme. But if during the year, say during the year, the value of supplies exceeds this basic threshold limits, then he will have to opt out for the composition scheme and follow the regular scheme of taxation. How will he opt out? Again, so here a form GST ITC-03 will have to be filed within a period of 60 days from the commencement of the year. And the ITC has to be reversed by debiting the electronic credit or the cash ledger. And how the ITC reversal shall be done? ITC reversal, the amount to be reversed is equivalent to ITC on inputs held in stock or contained in semi-finished goods or finished goods held in stock. So whatever input tax credit which is there in the stocks which are lying with the dealer on the date of opting out is required to be reversed, not all the input tax credit. And in case of capital goods also, the input tax credit will have to be reversed in case, say, if the dealer has purchased some furniture and on which he has availed input tax credit when he was earlier under the regular scheme of taxation, and then he wants to switch over to the composition scheme. Whatever input tax credit has been purchased on the capital goods, a proportionate reversal will have to be done in case of capital goods by taking the useful life of those capital goods as 5 years. So basically it is 4 quarters in a year, which amounts to 20 quarters in all in totality. So 5% per quarter would be the reduction which will be applicable in case of the capital goods on which input tax credit has been claimed by the dealer. So there are 8 quarters. So 40% ITC will be available. The balance 60% ITC will have to be reversed at the time of opting for the composition scheme. Of course, the reversals will have to be calculated separately for each of the branches of taxation of GST, that is CGST, SGST, and IGST. And such reversal will be added to the output tax liability of the dealer. And the electronic credit or cash ledger will be debited to that extent. And the balance, if any, will lapse. So I think that is again a big blow for the dealers. Because in case the dealer is opting out of the composition scheme, the balance credit gets lapsed. Coming to a second example, Mr. B, a registered taxable person, was paying tax under the composition scheme. On 31st July, his aggregate turnover crosses rupees 1.5 crore. On 31st July, the option availed to pay tax under section 10(1) shall lapse and B shall become liable to pay. So on the date it crosses the 1.5 crore limit, the person will become liable to pay tax. Mr. B will be eligible to claim of ITC on the inputs held in stock contained in semi-finished goods or finished goods held in stock. And on the capital goods as on 30th July 2019, he will have to file ITC 01 within 30 days. See, earlier it was a different form. Here it is the person has exceeded the turnover limit. There it was a case of opting in into the scheme. This is the case where the turnover, aggregate turnover, has crossed the limit prescribed for a composition dealer of 1.5 crores. Then what is to be done? And this limit has prescribed in between the year on 31st of July 2019. So whatever stock remains with the dealer. So now is the case where the dealer was under a composition scheme he'll be going out of the composition scheme. In the earlier case, he was going into the composition scheme, and hence the ITC was to be reversed. Here is a case where the dealer was already under composition scheme, and because of exceeding the aggregate turnover 1.5 crores, he becomes liable to pay tax under the regular scheme of taxation. We all know that being a composition dealer, the dealer was not liable to claim input tax credit. But once if such dealer becomes a regular taxpayer, he becomes eligible for input tax credit. So whatever goods are lying in stock, say on the date when the turnover limit, aggregate turnover limit has crossed, that is 31st July 2019 in this case, the dealer will become eligible to claim the input tax credit. How he will do that? He will be able to claim ITC of the inputs held in stock, inputs contained in semi-finished goods or finished goods held in stock and on the capital goods as on 30th July 2019. By that, he can file by filing GST ITC 01 within 30 days, that is on or before 30th August 2019. So whatever goods are in lying in stock as on 31st July 2019, the ITC will be available only qua the stocks which are lying. It will not be available qua if any services are availed by the dealer, then that those have already been consumed. There is no, nothing can be done of the services. But as far as the goods are there, which are lying in stock, credit will be available. The credit will also be available on capital goods. So again, let's take a scenario. In this scenario, the dealer say he's registered as a composition dealer right since 1st July 2017. He had purchased capital goods. On purchase of those capital goods at that point of time, when he had opted for the composition scheme, he had not claimed any input tax credit. So the capital goods were purchased before 2 years. So up to 2 years, say that is 5% per quarter from the date of invoices, he will not be eligible for taking the input tax credit. So for 2 years, that is 40% ITC will not be available qua those capital goods. On the balance 60%, the ITC will become eligible to be claimed by the dealer. And now again, there will be issue of how to do the reporting, how to do the compliances. Since he was a composition dealer for a part of the year and will be a regular dealer for the balance part of the year. So for the first quarter, the dealer will be filing GST CMP 08. As I told earlier, for 1920, the dealer was required to file quarterly returns in CMP 08. So he will file CMP 08 for the first quarter, that is April to June. For the month of July also, a CMP 08 will have to be filed, and at the end of the year a GSTR 4 will have to be filed for the details for the period from 1st of April till 30th of July 2019, till the date he has exceeded the turnover limit. From 1st July 2019 onwards, we shall be required to file the regular 3B and GSTR 1 as per the provisions of the regular sections 37 and 39 on the respective due dates as are applicable. Well, we did not find, could not find any AR on the composition scheme. Possibly, I think the smaller dealers, none of them have ventured into going for an AR. Anyway, most of those ARs are adverse rulings which have been faced by the dealers. But of course, they do provide the thought process of the department of how the department is going to take cognizance of the various facts of the case. But one case which I came across, a very recent one, was regarding a dealer who had opted for the composition scheme under section 10 for supply of goods and was also providing renting of immovable property. The basic question which comes in this case is that can the dealer opt for both the schemes as a supplier of goods and as a supplier of services? his turnover is below the limit. Let's take a case that the turnover is below limits for supply of services. Also, the turnover is say only 40 lakh of rupees of that dealer. Can he avail both the schemes and sell the goods at 1% and provide the services at the rate of 6%? Or he cannot do so? Because when we come to the scheme for the service providers, basically it is not a scheme only for service providers. The 50 lakh, the scheme of 50 lakhs turnover, where tax can be paid at the rate of 6%, that scheme is available to any person who is below that turnover limit and who is not eligible under the composition scheme as per section 10(1), which is for the supply of goods. Say, for example, there is a pure service provider who is providing services. That person can definitely opt for the composition scheme under section 10(2)(a), which is the 50 lakh composition scheme. Say the service provider is also supplying certain goods at the while providing the services. Is there a debar that such service providers cannot opt for the services composition scheme? There is no such debar for such service providers. So in case there is a works contractor or a small contractor who is supplying goods as well as services and he wants to opt for the composition scheme, which is the service providers composition scheme, we can name it as the service providers composition scheme, such persons can provide the goods under that scheme, can supply the goods under that scheme. Again, if there is a supply of goods as well as supply of service under the second option, then what would be the rate of tax which would be applicable? I'm taking an example of a contractor who is opting for composition scheme of the service provider schemes, that is the below 50 lakh turnover criteria. He is supplying goods also, he is supplying services also. He is not eligible for the composition scheme under section 10(1) because his turnover of services is more than 10% of the aggregate turnover of that of his total turnover. So he is not eligible under the composition scheme under section 1. Now he wants to sell goods also and he wants to provide services also. So what should be the rate of tax that should be applicable? Because if he opts for the composition scheme for goods, he gets the concessional rate of 1% being a composition dealer. But if he has opted for the service provider's composition scheme, then on the supply of goods, and say he is supplying goods separately and he is supplying services separately, and the goods are say going at the rate of 18%, or 12%, and the services are generally which are charged at the rate of 18%, and he is supplying both of them. So under this second scheme, he will be liable to pay tax at the rate of 6% both for the supply of services as well as for the supply of goods. He cannot take a plea that he is a composition dealer and so for goods he will pay tax at the rate of 1%. And for services, he will pay tax at the rate of 6%. That option is not available to the dealer. So similar was the case of this empathic trading center. Similar was the case of this empathic trading center, wherein I'm not going through this entire AR. The ruling is that the applicant is eligible to be in the composition scheme under section 10. If the turnover of services of the applicant does not exceed 10% of the turnover in the state, the applicant is not eligible to opt to pay tax under notification 2/2019, as the applicant is already registered as a composition taxpayer, because the applicant was already registered and eligible as a composition taxpayer under section 10(1), is not eligible under section 10(2)(a), and that is what the ruling works. In this ruling, there was one more question, which is a separate question, and it is not directly linked to the point 1 and 2. There was a separate question that in case he wants to opt for the scheme, then what would be the rate of tax? Can the dealer charge separate rates for supply of goods as well as supply of services? The authority in that case has mentioned that for the entire value, 3% CGST and 3% KGST. That is 6% GST will have to be charged on the entire value of supplies, and he cannot pay tax at 1% on supply of such goods if he is opting for the service providers composition scheme. Well, I think these were some of the issues which I thought were very much necessary for this composition scheme. We'll take up the second topic now, reverse charge mechanism under GST. Of course, there are various issues under reverse charge mechanism also. And then we'll take up the questions. Well, we all know that in case if the dealer is a supplier of goods, he has to collect tax as from the recipient and remit the tax periodically to the government. And that is called normally as a forward charge. But however, under reverse charge mechanism, the recipient has to remit the tax to the government. It is the liability of the recipient to discharge the tax liability on the goods or services which are received by him. RCM is not new under the GST regime. It was there under the service tax regime also. And the GST law has carried forward that the same legacy. When we are talking of reverse charge mechanism under GST, we need to understand that section 9.3 and 9.4 of the CGST Act, these are the two main provisions which talk about levy of GST under reverse charge mechanism, and the corresponding sections are section 5.3 and 5.4 of the IGST Act. Section 2, subsection 98 of the CGST Act defines reverse charge. Let's read what does it say. Reverse charge means liability to pay tax by the recipient of supply of such goods or services or both instead of the supplier of goods or services or both under section 3 or subsection 3 or 4 of section 9 or under section 5.3 or 5.4 of the IGST Act. So basically it means the liability is to pay tax is on the recipient instead of the supplier. So in forward charge, the receiver of the services makes payment with GST to the supplier and the supplier remits that money to the government. Under reverse charge, the receiver himself deposits the GST to the government. We don't pay it to the supplier and the supplier pays it to the government. The recipient directly pays it to the government. Now we saw that there are two sections, section 9.3 as well as section 9.4. What does section 9.3 of the CGST Act says? It says that the government will notify the specific categories of supply of goods or services or both the tax on which shall be paid under reverse charge basis. So the category of supply of goods and services will be specified, and if such categories of goods or services are being supplied, the recipient will be liable to pay tax under this act as if he is the person liable to pay tax, and all the provisions of the act, including tax, interest, penalty, filing of returns, etc., shall be applicable to such recipient. When we go to section 9.4 of the CGST Act, we need to understand that section 9.4 has been amended with effect from 1st February 2019. Earlier, prior to its substitution, section 4 read as under: the central tax in respect of the supply of taxable goods or services or both by a supplier who is not registered to a registered person shall be paid by such person on reverse charge basis. Basically, this is the tax on URD purchases which was required to be paid under reverse charge mechanism. There were lots of issues which were being faced by the recipients. To identify whether the supplier was unregistered, the recipient could not know whether it's an interstate supply or an interstate supply. Bill pakka nahi aata hai, malum hi nahi where the dealer is. So whether it's interstate or interstate itself was an issue. Again, the normal issue which is faced by most of the dealers is whether the supply is a mixed supply or a composite supply. So in case of URD purchases, the recipient never knew that the supply which is received by him is a mixed supply or a composite supply, because based on that supply value, the tax will be payable by the recipient. And hence the rate of tax, identifying the rate of tax was a big difficulty. Also identifying HSN code and service accounting code was a difficulty. Ascertaining the time of supply was also a difficulty. The government had come out with a threshold limit of 5,000 per day in case the URD purchases were less than 5,000 per day, then no tax was payable under reverse charge by the recipient. However, the applicability of this section was suspended by notification number 38 dated 13th October 2017 by omitting the provisos in notification number 8/2017. So one issue which arises over here is, and which has been taken up and discussed at various forums. When we see this notification number 8/2017, and when we go through the notification, the way it has been worded, it says that when we go to the beginning of that notification, it says that all purchases from unregistered dealers are exempted. Then it comes to a proviso which says that except when they are more than 5,000 rupees, if the purchases from unregistered dealers are more than 5,000 rupees, then they will be liable for reverse charge mechanism. That is how the wordings of section 9 of notification 8/2017 were, which were issued under section 9.4 of the CGST Act. By notification number 38/2017, the said proviso was omitted and the operation of section 9.4 was suspended. That was suspended first till 31st of March 2018, then extended till March 19, then September 19. So that is how that the time limit was pushed through. The question which was being raised that by omitting the proviso, whether the effect of that proviso, of omitting that proviso, does it mean that tax on URD purchases was never to be paid right since 1st July 2017? Or is it that the tax on URD purchases is not payable by 13th October 2017? Well, according to me, I think since there is no specific mention in the entire notification that this is going to have a retrospective effect or deemed to be effective from a particular date, omitting the proviso from a particular date will curtail the provisions of that section from that particular date only and would not give a retrospective date to that notification. Well, there are differing views on that. I will request our chairman, Sujata Madam, chairperson, to kindly share her views on this when she delivers her talk, that by omitting the provision, whether it will have the prospective effect or the effect would be retrospective. The section 9.4 was substituted from 1st of February 2019. Earlier, if you see the earlier section, it stated that when the goods or service or both are by a supplier who is not registered to a registered person, the wordings were only when it is from a URD to RD, then 9.4 triggers and tax is payable under reverse charge mechanism. But now, the government has made certain changes in this amended or substituted subsection 4 of section 9. What does it say? The government will specify a class of registered persons who shall, in respect of supply of specified categories of goods or services or both received from an unregistered supplier, pay tax on reverse charge basis. So earlier it was on all purchases being made by a registered dealer from an unregistered dealer that were liable. Now all purchases will not be liable. So there are two clauses which are made, which are inserted now. The class of registered persons who shall pay is specified, and specified categories of goods or services from unregistered person, that will also be notified. So if the provision is going to be again made applicable in future, and that appears to be the intention of the government, and because that was the premises of the entire GST, that there has to be a value addition and a set off at every stage of the transaction of the supply of goods or services, and credit should be available. And that was the primary, that was the basic intention of introducing this section 9.4, and a big basis of envisaged by the government that all supplies, see, the what we understand is that all supplies would be chargeable to tax when they are made by a registered dealer. When they are made by an unregistered dealer, the recipient was liable to pay tax, so that there is a parity. The input tax credit is available to the recipient, and whatever further supplies are being made, the input tax credit of the tax is paid either under supplies received as forward charge or on taxes paid under reverse charge. Both of them would be available to that particular registered person. But that never came in. There were various issues being faced by the dealers all across the country, and hence this provision was suspended. And now the government has taken powers to specify that not all registered persons will be liable to pay tax under reverse charge for purchases from a registered dealer, but it will be a specified class and for specified categories. Let's wait for the notification. As of now, no notification has been issued. So we are saved off all this exercise, and maybe in future, this may come in. Well, apart from the provisions of section 9.3 and 9.4, where tax is payable under reverse charge mechanism, and there the precise wordings are that it is tax under reverse charge mechanism. But we cannot ignore section 5.1 of the IGST Act, which is regarding IGST payable on the import of goods. The proviso to section 5.1 of IGST Act states that integrated tax on goods imported into India shall be levied and collected in accordance with section 3 of the Customs Tariff Act on the value as determined at the point when duties of customs are levied on the said goods under section 12 of the Customs Act. Basically, on import of goods, whatever tax is payable, although it is not a tax directly as a reverse charge, it is a tax which is paid on import of goods. But the recipient of the goods is paying the tax, and hence I thought that I should at least mention it over here. It is not a tax under reverse charge mechanism, but it is a tax on import of goods, which is paid by the recipient. It's an analogy which can be done that the recipient needs to pay tax on import of goods at the time of importing the goods when duties of customs are levied on the said goods. There are certain supplies which are exempted from reverse charge mechanism. We have notification number 9, CTR. CTR implies central tax rate notification. So wherever CTR I mentioned, it will mention central tax rate notifications. As per this notification, it exempts the supplies of goods or services or both received by a TDS deductor under section 51 of the CGST Act from any supplier who is not registered from the whole of central tax leviable under section 9.4, subject to the condition that deductor is not liable to be registered otherwise than under section 24.6. I think, again, there is not much relevance in the sense that this is more applicable under section 9.4 from purchases made by a registered dealer. Only we need to understand that TDS as of now is applicable only to the government entities. Out of those government entities, there are specific government entities who are registered only for paying, for deducting TDS and paying to the government, because under section 24.6, the persons who are liable to deduct TDS are liable to get registered. Maybe such government companies might not be supplying goods and there is no tax on their outward liabilities. And that is what the notification mentions. Similar notifications will find ahead also in subsequent provisions also, that such government companies who are liable to deduct TDS, but they have taken registration only for the purpose of deducting TDS. And not otherwise. Then, certain exemptions are provided to such companies from the compliances. Then, as per notification 10, supplies of second-hand goods purchased from unregistered suppliers by the dealers operating under margin scheme again, since URD tax as of now is not available, but when it was there, if a dealer is buying second-hand goods, say a dealer is a second-hand car dealer, he is buying a second-hand car from any other person, and he's under the margin scheme where he is buying a car for 50,000, selling it for 60,000. The tax payable by such second-hand car dealer, say it is on 10,000 rupees only, because he is under the margin scheme. Then on the URD purchases made by such dealers, no URD tax was payable. It is mentioned over here. We also need to understand the time of supply and for goods and services when we talk about reverse charge mechanism. We all know that time of supply of goods have been provided specifically for goods which are liable to tax under forward charge, but also under reverse charge, specific provisions are there to identify the time of supply of goods. What is the provision? It says that, now I am on section 12.3, which talks about time of supply of goods. In case of supplies in respect of which tax is paid or liable to be paid on reverse charge basis, the time of supply shall be earliest of the following dates. It is either the date of receipt of goods or the date of payment as entered in the books of accounts of the recipient, or the date on which payment is debited in his bank account, or date immediately following 30 days from the date of issue of invoice or any other document by whatever name called. So when a person buys the goods and he receives the goods, that becomes the date. Or when he enters in his books of accounts but the goods are not yet received, that becomes the date. Or only if an invoice has been received by the dealer who is liable to pay tax under reverse charge, but the goods are not yet received or the payment is not made, then within 30 days, the liability to pay tax under reverse charge triggers. As far as service, it is similar. Only thing is that there is no receipt of goods clause because it is services. It is earliest of the following dates. The date of payment as entered in the books of accounts. So the date of payment becomes the date when the liability to tax arises. Say a payment is made on 15th of June to a dealer for who is providing the services, and those services are liable under reverse charge mechanism, then that date shall be considered to be the time of supply for discharging the tax liability. Or in case the dealer has issued an invoice, say that the invoice is received by the recipient, but the supply is not made, then there's a time limit of 60 days, which will trigger for determining the liability to pay tax under RCM. So this points need to be taken into consideration whenever the payment is made or amount is debited to the books of account, or 60 days from the date of invoice if the supplies are not received. It is earliest of these dates where the liability to pay tax for services received under reverse charge mechanism. Well, there is one more aspect which needs to be considered, and which is I think not complied with by most of the taxpayers, is self-invoicing under reverse charge mechanism. Well, every supply which is received by a dealer who is liable to pay tax under section 9.3 or 9.4. 9.3 is the specified categories of supplies, say GTA services or legal services. 9.4 are the purchases from URD. Wherever a person is making is receiving supplies under section 9.3 or 9.4, that registered person, as per section 31.3F, shall issue an invoice in respect of goods or services or both received by him from the supplier who is not registered on the date of receipt of goods or services or both. So this date is different from the earlier date which we saw regarding time of supply of goods and services. The dates for time of supply of goods and services are the liability to pay tax. And here is the time limit to raise a self-invoice. This is for the self-invoice which needs to be raised by the dealer. Khud hi invoice banao, khud hi credit lo. Right, but invoice will have to be prepared in such cases. a small concession was given for to the registered persons for making a consolidated invoice at the end of the month for supplies covered under section 9.4. So URD for URD purchases, a consolidated invoice was allowed as per rule 46 second proviso, that a dealer could make a consolidated invoice. But that is not the case in case of other supplies, wherein the person will have to make a self invoice. And in case any advance is being paid by the dealer, before receiving the goods or the services, the such dealer will have to issue a payment voucher at the time of making payment to the supplier. Let's understand one thing. This self-invoice series should be reflected in the document details in GSTR 1 in table number 13.2. The government is also asking the registered taxable person to provide these details of the self-invoices issued under reverse charge mechanism in GSTR 1. I don't know how many of us are providing those details or are maintaining those details, but yes, that is the provision, and that can be an issue which can come up in future, because the law stands there as it is. It may be a difficult provision for many small taxpayers to prepare a self-invoice, but it's a good habit to prepare it and reflect it in GSTR 1, because otherwise all the provisions of the Act for non-compliance with the provisions of the Act are applicable. All the penal consequences are also applicable in such cases. Hence, preparing a self-invoice for liabilities under RCM is a necessity. One more important aspect, tax under reverse charge basis shall be paid through electronic cash ledger only. Even if there are so many persons who come and tell that I am having credit balance, aap mujhe fir se cash bharne ke liye kyun bol rahe ho, itna to credit pada hai. No, let's understand that this tax was payable in lieu of the person who was going to pay tax to the government, and an input tax credit was to be taken by the recipient, right? So tax was to be paid to the government, and hence the government has made a specific provision in section 49.4, read with rule 85.4, that tax under reverse charge shall be paid through electronic cash ledger only. Of course, as per rule 56.1, all supplies attracting tax on reverse charge along with the relevant documents are true. The dealer have to keep and maintain the accounts. There is an invoice level information in respect of all outward supplies attracting reverse charge, which is required to be furnished in GSTR 1 of Table 4B. So this invoice level information in Table 4B is also required in GSTR 1. Then the tax payable under reverse charge is also required to be reflected in 3B. Why we need to understand all these provisions is that whenever we are talking of liabilities under reverse charge, we need to understand that, first of all, we need to identify where is the liability, what is the liability. We need to pay it. We need to pay it in cash and not through electronic credit. We need to disclose it in our GSTR 1 return as well as in GSTR 3B returns. And then after paying the tax, if whatever input tax credit is available of the tax paid on a reverse charge basis, that can be claimed. And that should again be reflected separately in the GSTR 3B table number 4A3. When we go to GSTR 3B, again, there are specific columns for reflecting ITC paid on import of goods, on import of services, as well as on paid under RCM. So that differentiation also needs to be taken. One more important aspect which is critical is that, as per section 24.3, a person paying tax under reverse charge mechanism has to compulsorily get registered even if the turnover is below the threshold limit. So there are various companies or charitable organizations which may not be required to take registration because they are either under the below the threshold limit or they are providing only exempt supplies. But still, if they are required to get registered So the question is that whether such companies are required to get registered. I'll take it through an example. Are charitable organizations who are providing exempt services liable for registration if they receive services liable for reverse charge mechanism? Let's understand this. The first provision, when we go to section 24, subsection 3, it states that every person who is liable to pay tax under reverse charge mechanism is liable for registration. Now, say this charitable organization is an organization which is providing only exempted services and not providing any other taxable services. Then whether such organizations who are receiving supplies under reverse charge mechanism, are they liable to take registration and do the compliances? Well, we need to see section 23 also, because when we refer to section 24, it says notwithstanding anything contained in section 22, it is not overriding section 23. Section 23, which is relating to registration, gives an exemption. And what is that exemption? Any person engaged exclusively in the business of supplying goods or services or both that are not liable to tax or are wholly exempt from tax under this act are not liable for registration under section. Are not liable for registration under section 23. So, in my view, if a charitable organization is providing pure exempt services, then still it will not be liable for registration in spite if it is receiving services under reverse charge mechanism. But I think there are very few organizations, such organizations which are providing pure exempt services, because we have been going through and seeing the transactional activities of various organizations. And most of them are also providing taxable services. And if such organizations are providing exempt as well as taxable services, then, and of course, if they are below the threshold limit, but if they are availing any services which are liable for registration, then such organizations will have to take registration and discharge their liability under reverse charge mechanism. Let's take one more example. Whether an unregistered proprietary firm having an aggregate turnover of rupees 15 lakhs is liable for registration if it receives services liable for reverse charge mechanism. Well, such dealers are not liable to tax because they have not crossed the threshold exemption limit, and hence they will not be liable for taking registration under GST. Now let's come to the notifications which have been issued. As regards liability to tax under reverse charge mechanism, there are separate notification for supply of goods as well as supply of services. Notification number 4/2017 is for supply of goods. These are specific supplies of goods which are liable to reverse charge mechanism. It is not applicable to all goods. Only these goods, cashew nuts, bidi wrappers, tobacco leaves, silk yarn, etc., which are supplied by a specified person, say agriculturist in this case, and received by a registered person, these only are liable to reverse charge. Other goods are not liable to reverse charge. This is not the URD purchases under section 9.3. These are the specified categories of goods on which tax is payable under reverse charge mechanism, raw cotton and supply of lottery. So these are the categories which are liable to reverse charge, the supply of goods. Then seized vehicles and confiscated vehicles, when they are sold by the central government, the registered person who is buying such confiscated goods from the government, that person will be liable to pay tax under reverse charge mechanism. In case of priority sector lending certificate, which are considered goods, this is generally in the banking sector where the banks are providing a priority lending to their as per the norms given by the RBI, and such certificates are being issued. So this is applicable in very in those cases only. And such priority lending certificate, even if they are by a registered person to another registered person, the recipient will be liable to pay tax under reverse charge mechanism. Let's take up the issues which related to the services which have been notified under reverse charge mechanism. We have section 9.3 read with notification number 13/2017. Various categories of services have been notified over here. The first is the category of the goods transport agency. So if a recipient of services is receiving supplies from a goods transport agency, that recipient will be liable for paying tax under reverse charge mechanism. Well, while talking of GTA services, we need to understand that there are specified categories of recipient of services who are liable. They are a person registered under GST, a factory, a society, including cooperative society, a body corporate, let's say a private limited or limited company, a partnership firm, LLP, AOP, a casual taxable person. Any person who is receiving supplies from the GTA, such companies are liable to pay tax under reverse charge mechanism. The exclusions from reverse charge mechanism have been given to those government companies who are liable to deduct TDS but not making any outward supplies. They are exempted. Now, in case of GTA services, there are three parties who are involved. There's the consigner, there's the consignee, and there's the goods transport agency. The goods transport agency themselves also have the option of paying tax under forward charge mechanism. So in case if a goods transport agency is paying tax under forward charge mechanism, then the recipient of the GTA services need not pay tax under reverse charge. Second, if the GTA service provider is not levying tax under forward charge mechanism, but the tax is payable by the recipient, the question is that who will pay the tax, the consignor or the consignee? The provision makes it very clear that the person who is liable to pay freight for the transportation of goods of goods by road in a goods carriage shall be treated as the person who receives the service. So if the consignor is liable to make payment to the transport agency, the consignor will be liable to pay tax under reverse charge mechanism. If the consignee is liable to make payment to the goods transport agency, it will be the consignee who will be liable to pay tax under reverse charge mechanism. So basically, where the freight expenses are booked by the consignor or the consignee, whoever is booking those freight expenses is the person who is liable to pay tax under GTA. The consignment note also should mention that who will be liable, whether the GTA, the consignor or the consignee. The consignment note has also been specified. That consignment note needs to specify that who will the person who will be liable to pay tax under reverse charge mechanism. Then an issue arises in case of tempo charges, which are hiring charges. In the transport business, there are various categories of service providers. There are few categories of service providers who are only hiring their vehicles. A person is only hiring a tempo, and he's not directly providing the services to the person whose goods are being transported. So the question is that, and in case he is providing those services to another GTA, who further is providing the services to the recipient or to the person who is transporting the goods, then whether such service providers, such persons who are providing their goods on hire to the GTA, whether they are liable to tax either under forward charge or whether the recipient, that is the GTA, would be liable under reverse charge mechanism. Well, that clarification has been given by the government that in case a person who is providing his transport vehicle to another GTA, then tax is not payable either by the person who is giving the goods on hire to such GTA, nor the GTA is liable to pay tax under reverse charge mechanism for the services of tempo hire charges received from another transporter. So I think as far as the tempo hire charges are concerned, if they are according to a GTA, then tax is not payable. But if the tempo is hired directly by the person who is transporting the goods, say the person says, I'll hire your tempo for 1 month, and whatever goods I want to supply qua that, I will be making the supplies directly. Such tempo hiring persons or service providers do not issue a consignment note. So whether the recipient would be liable to, and say that tempo hirer, the person who is giving the tempo on hire, is not registered under GST, then whether the recipient of this tempo hiring services will be liable to tax under reverse charge mechanism is the issue. Well, according to me, reverse charge mechanism will apply in the GTA cases only where the GTA issues a consignment note. A person who is only giving his tempo on hire is not issuing a consignment note. A consignment note is a document issued by a goods transport agency against the receipt of goods for the purpose of transporting the goods by goods in a by a, in a in a goods carriage. So in such cases, the recipient of services will not be liable to pay tax under the reverse charge mechanism. I think there are certain cases where whatever transport charges are there, the people are paying tax under the reverse charge mechanism. But this is one category. If these are the tempo charges, then and there is no consignment note issued by such on hiring of such tempos, then tax would not be payable under reverse charge mechanism. Coming to legal services. In case of legal services, these are the services which are provided by an individual advocate, including a senior advocate or a firm of advocates, by way of legal services directly or indirectly. So the supplier of services is an advocate or a firm of advocate, and the recipient of service is a business entity. So whenever any legal fees are paid to an advocate, the liability to pay tax under reverse charge mechanism triggers. The business entity located in the taxable territory who is the litigant, applicant, or the petitioner shall be treated as the person who receives the legal services for the purpose of this notification. So the business entity has to be the litigant or the applicant or the petitioner. Then only it is liable to pay tax qua those legal services under RCM. So if the legal services are received in individual capacity, whether RCM is applicable, in my view, no. If the legal services are received in individual capacity, RCM is not applicable. Only if they are received by the person as a business entity, then only it will be liable to tax under reverse charge mechanism. Then there are certain issues regarding to import of services by a firm of advocates. Well, import of services, if we see, there is a separate notification for import of services as well as for import of goods under ocean freight. There is a separate notification where import of services are covered separately. So in case a firm of advocates is importing services from a firm which is outside India, then whether that firm of advocates will be liable for reverse charge mechanism. That's the issue. Well, since the service provider is a firm of advocates and the service recipient is also a firm of advocates, qua the services received, even if they are import of services, the firm of advocates will not be liable for paying tax under reverse charge mechanism in those cases. However, if the services of an architect from UK are availed by a firm of advocates in India, whether they'll be liable for RCM, I think yes. In case if there are import of services other than legal services which are availed by a firm of advocates, they'll be liable for registration, and they'll be liable to pay tax under reverse charge mechanism. In case of export of services by a firm of advocates, whether They are covered by entry 2 of notification 13/2017. This is the entry 2. Services provided by advocate, he is a supplier, and the recipient is any business entity located in the taxable territory. So if the services of the advocate are being received by a person who is outside India, they are not in the taxable territory. So possibly there is no reverse charge mechanism applicable in such cases. Such services become liable to tax as export of services, either on payment of tax or the form of advocates can take a letter of undertaking, and ultimately there will be no outward liability. But for that, a registration would be required in such cases. So in case of export of services by form of advocates, registration might become necessary. Otherwise, the form of advocates might not be required to tax to take a registration. What is the taxability on reimbursement of expenses other than legal fees? In case if there are other fees like stamp duty, etc., which are being collected by the firm, whether tax is payable on the entire value, say the invoice value is 1 lakh rupees and there are 10,000 stamp duty charges which are collected by the advocate, then that collection or reimbursement of expenses, if it is as a pure agent, then tax will not be payable under reverse charge mechanism on that services which are availed as a pure agent, which are provided as a pure agent by the firm, but all other charges will be liable to reverse charge mechanism. I'm not taking up this sponsorship services. Just one issue in regard to sponsorship service. I'll be only taking up now the other issues which are involved in this reverse charge mechanism. We know that sponsorship services, in case of sponsorship services, the recipient of service who is a body corporate or a partnership firm located in the taxable territory is liable for reverse charge mechanism, for paying tax under reverse charge mechanism, and the supplier of service can be any person. So let's take an example. ABC Private Limited has sponsored cricket event of a PQR trust. The trust has raised invoice of rupees 1 lakh plus GST on ABC Private Limited. Whether ABC Private Limited would still be liable for paying tax under reverse charge mechanism? I think the issue here is, per se, as per this notification, it was the liability of ABC to pay tax under reverse charge for the sponsorship given for the cricket tournament of that particular trust. The trust was not liable to pay tax under forward charge mechanism. The trust could have been liable to pay tax under forward charge mechanism had it been that it was an advertisement which was issued, which was given by ABC Private Limited. There's a difference between a sponsorship and advertisement. So in case of advertisement, the tax is payable under forward charge mechanism. In case of sponsorship, the tax is payable under reverse charge mechanism. But now the position is that in this case, the trust has raised the invoice and collected tax as sponsorship charges from ABC Private Limited. So the issue is whether ABC Limited would still be liable for paying tax under reverse charge mechanism. Well, here maybe there was a similar situation, not exactly the same, but a similar situation which had come up under the service tax regime. In case of GTA services, in the case of Umasans Autocom Private Limited, wherein the appellant had paid service tax to the provider of GTA service. GTA service was covered under reverse charge and service provider had paid the tax to the government. It was held that there is no issue regarding...
Pranav, sorry to interrupt. Because we are left with very, very less time. And chairman will also have to speak. So and some queries will have to be taken up.
Okay.
So it's already 1:25.
Correct.
Can you please wrap up it in maybe 5 minutes?
I'll try. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. So in these cases, the tax has already been paid into the government treasury by the service provider, which was actually to be paid by the service recipient And if the service recipient is going to pay tax again, it would amount to double taxation. The time limits have gone for paying tax. The time limit for availing credits have also gone. So what could be the scenario? Well, a stand has been taken in Umasan's Autocom that in case the service provider has paid the tax, the service recipient will not be liable to pay tax under reverse charge mechanism. It will be a difficult proposition. Again, we need to litigate this point. This cannot be taken up as a routine matter. But in case if the service provider has already paid the tax, maybe some cognizance can be taken of this judgment. I'll now take up this another issue which has cropped up regarding director services. And the issue is where the supplier of service is a director of a company or a body corporate, and the recipient of service is the body corporate located in the taxable territory, the director services are liable to tax under reverse charge mechanism. Well, under reverse charge mechanism, GST shall not be applicable on remuneration paid to executive director where there's a contract of employment between the company and the director. So where the director is an employee of the company and any remuneration is paid to the director as an employee of the company, there will be no liability to tax under reverse charge mechanism. But however, if the sitting fees or commission which is paid to a director, if that commission is not a part of the salary, then and only if a commission is paid to the director, well, then those will be liable to tax under reverse charge mechanism. And other services which are not under the employment contract, which are provided by non-executive or independent directors, those only will be liable to reverse charge mechanism. Others will not be liable to reverse charge mechanism. Security services have become taxable since January 19. Renting of motor vehicle designed to carry passengers, there also there are various issues that has become liable to reverse charge with effect from 1st October 2019. I'll not take up the issues for renting. I'll just like to touch upon a few issues with regard to import of services. This is one area where there is lots of miss out which we are seeing, or where there are lots of lapses in case of import of services. Import of services is actually covered under section 9(3) of the CGST Act, and for that notification 10/2017 under IGST has been issued, and the list of services on which tax shall be paid under reverse charge as IGST, because these are import of services, IGST is payable, and these services are notified under section 9(3) by notification 10/2017. Here we need to understand that any service supplied by any person who is located in a non-taxable in territory to any person other than the non-taxable online recipient, those import of services are liable to tax. So because wherever there is an online recipient who is liable to pay tax, the person, that online recipient of import of services under import of services will be liable under reverse charge mechanism. If the recipient is a non-taxable online recipient, say an individual is downloading from Google Play Store and paying, then Google will be liable to pay tax on that and not the individual person. But if ABC software company is downloading a software which has come, or ABC Private Limited is downloading certain online data from a portal, then yes, it will be liable to tax under reverse charge mechanism. We also need to understand OIDR services. There's lots of issues with related to OIDR services under reverse charge mechanism. I'll not take up those services due to paucity of time. Services received, this is another category, ocean freight. I think this is one category which has again led to various disputes. In case of ocean freight, tax is payable under reverse charge mechanism by the recipient of services. Here, maybe I'll just take 2-3 minutes on this ocean freight. Well, in the case of import of goods, say a person is importing goods from USA. The person at USA who is the exporter is supplying the goods to the person in India. He is appointing a freight forwarder who is in Singapore and paying freight to the person in Singapore, and the goods are supplied on CIF value to the person in India, then tax is payable under RCM on the freight value which is embedded in that CIF value. Against this, there have been various court rulings, various judgments. Various persons have gone into litigation in the case of ocean freight, in the case of Mohit Minerals. The Gujarat High Court held that the notification levying tax on supply of ocean freight service and making the importer of goods as the person liable for paying tax are unconstitutional, as there is no statutory sanction or levy and collection of tax. Basically, what has happened, the service recipient has been identified through the notification, and that service recipient has been made liable to pay tax for supplies which are happening outside the state. The freight forwarder in Singapore had supplied services to the exporter in USA, and there are no services which were being supplied to the person in India by that freight forwarder. Still, the person in India was made liable to pay tax under reverse charge basis, under reverse charge mechanism on such ocean freight. And the Gujarat High Court has held this entry as unconstitutional. There are other states also wherein such cases are lying with the high courts. There are differing judgments also coming, and so we need to wait what is going to be the status of this cases and what Supreme Court is going to finally deliver the judgment in such cases. So RCM motion on ocean freight is an issue as of now. I can only suggest that if the credit is available for the tax payable on ocean freight, pay the tax and avail the credit to be on a safer side. Otherwise, in case if you are a dealer who is providing exempted goods or exempted services and you want to litigate, then maybe a stand can be taken, of course, with due consultation of the pros and cons with the client about the liability on ocean freight. One more last issue which I wanted to just touch upon was regarding the input tax credit under RCM. Dinesh, I'll just take 2 more minutes if you permit. The last issue I'll take up.
Pranav bhai, I do not have any problem if chairman is okay with it.
Okay, man. Yeah, so this is the issue regarding the input tax credit on the reverse charge mechanism liability. So we all know that the liability needs to be discharged based on the time of supply of the goods or services. And we have gone through those provisions. So say for the year 2018-19, there is a liability which was required to be discharged by a recipient, but that has not been discharged, and that during the audit which is happening in the month of June 2020, I know most of us are trying to work from home and complete all our assignments of GST audits. And if any liability is found out relating to reverse charge mechanism, and that is being paid, say in June 2020 for the period 18-19, whether the credit of that would be available or that would not be available. I think that is a big issue which is being faced by many. We have section 16.4 of the CGST Act, which states that the registered person shall not be entitled to take ITC in respect of any invoice after the due date of furnishing of return under section 39, that is by September. So the time limit for availing credit has passed. Section 16.4 refers to an invoice. When we go to section 2, subsection 66, which defines a tax invoice, it says that invoice or tax invoice means the tax invoice referred to in section 31. When we go to the rules, it again talks of an invoice issued by the supplier under section 31. That is a self-invoice under section 31(3)(f) subject to payment of tax for availing ITC. The GSTR 1 also requires information about such invoices. Section 37(3) is, of course, as of now, that rectification in the return cannot be made for any invoices or for that invoice details which have been provided, that time limit has gone. There is no system of GSTR 2A for communication of self invoices. Also, under the self-assessment regime, it is not feasible to expect that error or omission in GSTR 1 be rectified irrespective of the time limit. It appears that the invoice which is issued, the section 16(4), would trigger, read with all these sections. I am not going into details of all this, but I just want to make a point that the liability or the eligibility for input tax credit will be an issue read with section 16(4) because it speaks of an invoice when we go through the provisions of section 31(3)(f), section 2, subsection 66. It is the invoice against which the credit is to be taken, and I'm afraid that if that time limit has gone, it will be very, very difficult to take credit of the tax being paid under reverse charge mechanism for the period 2018-19 in 2020. So that is going to be a big issue for claiming credit. Of course, there is another theory that since the tax is being paid in June 2020 and the credit thereof is being taken by the dealer only after paying the tax, so the government has got all its due credit and then only the credit is being availed by the recipient. That theory is there, but I think that theory will have to be tested and tried in the courts for claiming credit under reverse charge mechanism. There are chances that the department may not allow the credit for RCM as per section 16(4) because the time limit has elapsed. One more point was regarding that 180 days limit is not applicable to RCM credit. And another aspect regarding ITC was that a supplier shall not be eligible to claim input tax credit on goods or services used to make supplies on which recipient is liable to pay tax under reverse charge mechanism. These are the cases, say in the case of a person who is supplying outward supplies on which the recipient is going to pay tax under reverse charge mechanism, that person will not be eligible to claim input tax credit. I know there are lots of issues. The entire real estate sector is there. Maybe we can take it up some other time regarding the issues with related to RCM liability to the real estate sector. Maybe whatever issues are there as of now, we can take up those issues. I am really thankful to all the organizers for providing me this opportunity of sharing my views on various issues under reverse charge mechanism. We can either take up the questions now or maybe if Sujata madam wants to say anything, we can take up that first.
Sujata, my people are eager to listen to Sujata madam.
Yeah, yeah.
Because I have received several calls as to when Sujata madam is going to speak. So I think Sujata madam should speak for some time, and thereafter we can take up the, if time would permit and if the attendees remain in the meeting, we can take up the query.
Right.
Yeah, Sujata madam.
Tambre ji, we have to keep the queries aside. We have to listen the chairman only today, and we'll reply whatever the queries we have received in chat will be responded through this speaker and the chairman. They are also kindly requested to give us the replies of the several queries in writing so that we can circulate among the members. This is my advice.
Yes, sir. Yes, madam. Please. Is that the madam?
Yes,
May I request Sujata madam to speak? Pranav bhai, can you please stop the this sharing?
Yeah.
Vinod, can you please see whether Sujata madam is there in the this?
Yes, she is there.
Yeah, but then she you have to unmute her.
Yeah, we cut it. Yes, Sujata madam, please.
Hello, are you unmute? How can I talk?
Yeah. Sorry for that, madam.
Okay. Yeah, I was trying to call Dinesh. Only for that. Anyway, thank you, Pranav, for your very lucid and very exhaustive PPT which you have dealt with. We are sorry that you could not deal with the entire thing because of the paucity of time. Another time, we will definitely hear you fully so that we are totally, aware of the entire subject.
Madam, sorry to interrupt you. Can you please switch on your video? Because we can't see you.
Okay.
Let's go to me, but doctor.
Atau, theek hai?
Oh, please.
See, there are certain points which I would like to, it's not possible to, deal with all the, controversial points in both the topics. Now, first topic, which is composition, I would like to just bring to your notice section 10, which is dealing with the composition. It says that you, the subsection 4 of section 10 says that you will not collect any tax. The taxable person will not collect any tax who is under the composition scheme. Now here on 1st February 2019, section 1 of section 10, they have brought in an amendment which says that in lieu of the tax payable by him under subsection 1, an amount of tax calculated at rate. Now, prior to this amendment, one will recollect that this subsection 1 of section 9 and tax, these were the words which are not present. So after the amendment, these words have been, been present over there in this particular phraseology. Now here one has, what is the, when you say you are not or you are prohibited from collecting the tax, you have to see the definition of tax. Now, definition of tax is given in central's tax as well as state tax. In 2(21), it is central tax. 2(104), it is state tax. And it categorically states that it is the central tax under CGST Act under section 9. Okay. And we are dealing here with section 10. Now, the section 10 is not a charging section. Section 9 is the charging section. And the definition of tax also refers to section 9. So therefore, when you're talking about the tax which is in lieu of section 9(1), whether you have that authority to say that you will not, it is a charging section and you're trying to levy the tax through section 10 separately. That's the first point. And secondly, when you're talking about the tax over here and you say you will not collect the tax, I'm not collecting the tax. I'm collecting the composition money. So they ought to have been very specific and clear about what they're putting prohibition on. Because composition money, if you just go by the definition of tax, doesn't become the tax itself. And therefore, one will have to see that this prohibition qua the collection of tax will be valid or not, considering the definitions of tax over here. Secondly, the point is, see, they have stated there are different slabs of tax rate in respect of composition scheme for the manufacturers, for the other persons, for service providers, whatever. Now, they have considered for the purpose of turnover, the aggregate turnover. One can understand that. If you have a same pan, then all over India turnover will be considered for the purpose of specifying the limit. But so far as the payment of tax is concerned, it is qua the state turnover. So you'll be paying the tax in each state separately because you have a separate registration in each state. Now, supposing in one state, I'm a manufacturer. I'm just sending the goods in the other state. Oh, that will not happen in most cases for the composition dealer. But if it so happens, then will you be considered as a manufacturer in the other state also? Because in the first state, I'm a manufacturer. In the other state, I'm just reselling the goods. So will you be considered as a manufacturer? Because the liability is qua the state turnover in that state. Therefore, this problem also will have to be addressed. Secondly, see, in rule 5 of the CGST rules, which is dealing with the composition scheme, it clearly prohibits that in the opening stock as on the appointed date, that is 1/7/2017, there should not be any stock which is received by you by way of an interstate purchase or by interstate transfers, etc. I do not, as Pranav rightly said, there is no condition as regards or prohibition on the interstate purchases for a composition dealer. Although there is a prohibition on the interstate sales, there is no prohibition on the purchases. Then why should they have this kind of a condition? I think the logic seems to be that if a person has used this form C or form F for acquiring these goods, that is a concession he has availed of, and the legislature does not want to give further concession by way of a composition on the same goods, and they want to make it liable, or they just want to disentitle you from the composition scheme. But I think this is a very narrow-minded thinking of the legislature. And if you are extending some kind of a concession to the composition dealer, this kind of a petty condition should not have been levied by them. Now, there is also a condition so far as composition dealer is concerned. It says that he is not engaged in making any supply of goods which are not leviable to tax under this act. Now, this particular phraseology has not been defined, because what we have, the definitions is, so far as the CGST Act is concerned, taxable supply, non-taxable supply. These are the definitions we have. And in the non-taxable supply, we find that it is those supplies which are not leviable to tax under this act. So that phraseology, not leviable to tax, appears in the definition of non-taxable supply. Therefore, I feel here they are only referring to goods which are not under the purview of the composition scheme. And they do not intend to, you know, prohibit the supplies of exempt goods over here. Because one may try to interpret not leviable to tax to mean which are exempted under a notification or which are nil rated supplies. I don't think that seems to be the intention, but they ought to have been very clear on that front also. Now, coming to the RCM, he has very exhaustively dealt with the provisions. I have an issue with respect to the import of goods. Although he said that very strictly speaking, does not fit into the provisions of RCM as such. But since the importer, who is a recipient of the goods, is supposed to pay that tax IGST, he has included that particular slide in the RCM PPT. Now, he has also read out the proviso, which is most important here, under section 5, and which says that, I'll read it again, provided that the integrated tax on goods imported into India, so see the phraseology over here, goods imported into India, shall be levied and collected in accordance with the provisions of Section 3 of Customs Tariff Act on the value as determined under the said act at the point when duties of customs are levied on the said goods under Section 12 of the Customs Act 1962. So this is the provision. So what it means is, as soon as you import the goods, they cross the customs frontier and they come into the country or territory of India, you become liable to pay that tax. Now, so far as the constitutional power is concerned, which is granted to the parliament and the state legislature, is coming from Article 269A, which is inserted by the 101st Amendment to the Constitution, which reads as, goods and service tax on supplies in the course of interstate trade or commerce shall be levied and collected by the government of India, and such tax shall be apportioned between the union and state in the manner as may be provided by the parliament by law on the recommendations of the Goods and Services Tax Council. Now, there is an explanation below that, which says that for the purposes of this clause, supply of goods or of services or both in the course of import into the territory of India shall be deemed to be supply of goods or of services or both in the course of interstate trade or commerce. Now, here the phraseology used by the constitution maker is supply in the course of import. It will be treated as an interstate supply. Now here, when we look at the proviso, it simply says goods imported. So if it is not in the course of supply, can you still levy tax on such imported goods? Take a case of, you know, goods sent on approval basis, which have not been approved. But as soon as they received, are you supposed to pay the customs? Supposing I send them back again, the supply doesn't happen at all. In that case, am I supposed to pay tax? Because of this provision, because they have made appropriate amendments in the Customs Act also, subsection 7 has been inserted in section 3 of Customs Tariff Act, so as to levy IGST as if it is sort of a custom duty. Now, basically, import of goods is a taxable event which is under entry 82 of the union list. The importation of the goods is the taxable incidence, whereas IGST is leviable on the supply of the goods or services. So unless and until it is a supply, there could be many other cases which I can't visualize, which are not in the course of supply. In that case also, just because they have been imported, the tax will be levied. There is one more problem in this, that you can refer to Schedule 2, entry number 1, clause B. Now, Schedule 2, you know that certain transactions have been held as either supply of goods or of services, as has been specified over there. Now, clause B of entry 1 says that any transfer of right in goods or of undivided share in goods without the transfer of title thereof is supply of service. Okay. Then look at clause 5F. It says transfer of the title to use any goods for any purpose, whether or not for a specified period, for cash, deferred payment, or other valuable consideration, it shall also be considered as a service. Now, take an example of a lease agreement. I have a foreign party which has sent a machinery to India. Under a lease agreement with them, I will receive the machinery, I'll use it for a specified period, and then I will return that machinery back to the foreign party. On the lease rentals, I will be required to pay the IGST on the RCM basis here. But when the goods are imported, this machinery is imported. Because it is imported, it will be construed that the custom, the IGST will have to be paid on that because of the proviso under section 5. Yes. So, in that case, I am, as a lessee, required to pay the tax or IGST on the lease rentals also, and also on the importation of the goods. So there will be double taxation to that effect. I understand that there are some exemption notifications under the Customs Act to take care of this kind of thing, but they should have thought of it earlier, because whether it's just simply the supply of goods or supply of services under the GST law will have to be determined considering all these schedules, etc. And therefore, even if there are exemption notifications under the Customs Act, one, they are the concessions or the exemptions are given with conditions. So if I don't comply with the conditions such as giving of bond, etc., then I will be liable for that IGST on the importation of goods, as well as the IGST on the lease rentals also. So this is not fair. They should have thought of it. And this is a point which is a controversial point, according to me. Mm-hmm. Then, so far as SEZ is concerned, SEZ, we know that section 75B of the IGST Act It says that supply of goods or services or both to or by a special economic zone developer or a special economic zone unit shall be treated to be a supply of goods or services or both in the course of interstate trade or commerce. Now, when an SEZ unit supplies something, goods, which are covered by this which are supposing DTA, the DTA will file the bill of entry and it is required to pay the tax as like in any other importer because of the SEZ Act. Now, when the DTA, supposing it supplies the goods to an SEZ unit, which are falling into the notification meant for RCM, whichever number I don't recollect, that supposing the goods are falling in that RCM notification, then is the SEZ unit required to pay tax under RCM? Is there any specific exemption given to SEZ on that behalf? Now, one can argue, I mean, this is my argument on that, that the person, that is DTA, supplying the goods to an SEZ is a zero rated supply. So he is not required to pay the tax, or even if he pays, he gets the refund of that. Now, section 9.3 uses a particular phraseology or language, which says that, and the provisions of this act shall apply to such recipient as if he is the person liable for paying the tax in relation to such supply of goods or services or both. So when in the hands of DTA, it is treated as a zero rated supply, then in the hands of the SEZ, who is stepping into the shoes of a recipient, of course, the provisions are that clear, but still, if reading this language, one thinks that the recipient will step into the shoes of the supplier, then in the hands of SEZ also, this should be treated as a zero rated supply. But a clarification to that extent is needed. Then, Pranav said that the RCM, the liability under RCM can be paid only through the cash ledger. That's very right. But what is the analogy behind it? You look at the definition of output tax under section 2 bracket 82. Output tax in relation to a taxable person means the tax chargeable under this act on taxable supply of goods or services or both made by him or by his agent, but excludes tax payable by him on reverse charge basis. So output tax clearly excludes RCM tax. Okay. Now come to section 49.4. says the amount available in the electronic credit ledger may be used for making any payment towards output tax under this act and under the integrated tax in the manner and subject to conditions. So it only allows you to pay the output tax, which does not include the RCM tax. And therefore, one has to discharge his liability necessarily through the cash ledger. This is the analogy I feel is behind that particular provision. Then, so far as Pranav has also mentioned that if a transporter does not issue a consignment note, then he is supposed to, he is not coming under the RCM provisions at all. Now to that, I have certain, a few decisions wherein it has been held that if the transporter does not issue the consignment note, which is sort of a certificate that he has received the goods and he will be in custody of those goods and he will be responsible for the safe custody of those goods. That is a consignment note. And in absence of that, the RCM provisions will not be attracted. These are the cases, because under the erstwhile Service Tax Act also, we had the same provisions. Nadganj Sihori Sugar Mills, 34 STR 850, this is Delhi Tribunal, and that is CSTAT. Bhima Sahkari Sahkar Karkhana, this is Mumbai Tribunal. So these are few of the cases which says that consignment note, if it is not issued, the transporter will not come under the RCM provision. Now, the other question which Pranav had raised was in respect of notification number 8 of 2017. Now, on 1310, see, this notification, as Pranav has explained, contained a proviso which said that above 5,000 you will be liable for RCM, below 5,000 you will not be. So that was a condition. Otherwise, the exemption was given to all. But this was a proviso which put a condition on that. So therefore, when this notification number 38 came and it removed the proviso therein, what it did was it made that exemption available to everyone without any condition whatsoever. But if you look at that notification, it contained in point number 2 of that notification that this notification will come into effect from 1st July 2017. Now, this has been the practice of the notifications under GST, I mean, most of the times, if not all, that it shows that this is effective from so and so date. Now, this being a beneficial notification, and the notification originally stated that this will come into effect from 1st July 2017, according to me, there is a room to say that this notification will be effective from 1st July 17 itself, because it's a beneficial. It is not, you know, casting any obligation or additional duty or additional responsibility on you by way of a retrospective effect. When it is a beneficial notification, the legislature definitely can give a retrospective effect, but retrospective effect, it cannot be given unless and until there is an express provision or it is shown by an implication. Now, here by implication, when you say that the notification is effective from 1/7/17, there is a room to believe that it will be applicable from 1/7/17 onwards. I can refer to two Supreme Court judgments. One is ITO versus MC Panoos. It is open to a sovereign legislature to enact laws which have retrospective operation. The courts will not therefore ascribe retrospectivity to new laws affecting rights, unless by express words of necessary implication, it appears that such was the intention of the legislature in this case, because it very specifically is worded in that notification, it will come into effect from 1st of July. And it is not affecting your rights as such. On the contrary, it is giving you some benefit. So therefore, of course, it is, a very debatable matter. I'm not trying to say those who have already paid it and have claimed the ITC, the principle of unjust enrichment will apply over there. They will not get any benefit. But so far as the composition dealers are concerned, who have paid the tax and you cannot claim any ITC thereof, there the question of refund, etc., subject to the limitations in the section 54 relating to refund. There is another case of KC Sharma versus Union of India. The validity of the retrospective amendment in notification is not upheld in this case, since it adversely affected the rights of the SSE. It is violative of articles 14 and 16 of the Constitution. So it is when it is affecting the right. So it is by implication says that if it is a beneficial notification, then you can give a retrospective effect. And that should be very, either very clear or expressly mentioned, or it should be by implication. Now the notification number 38, which seeks to remove that proviso, ought to have said that this is deemed to have been removed with effect from 1/7/17 in abundant precaution. That has not been done. That could be one point which in favor of the revenue saying that we did not mean to, remove it from 1/7. But then it is a debatable matter according to me, and it's worth challenging before the court. These were some of the points which I felt I should deal with. I thank all the organizers as well as Pranav for very lucid and exhaustive presentation. Thank you so much.
Yes, thank you, madam. Thank you so much. We are already, it's 2:10, I think. Our official time is up to 1:30. We generally extend up to 1:45. But we both, Sugata madam and Pranav, have hold the participants. Still, we have 185 participants.